too.
Hey guys, welcome back. This is going to be game two of Navi vs. Orange. How can they come back from this 0-2? I don't know, man.
Wait, what?
It was a joke.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just like...
Yeah. We're not even sure. Whatever. All right, this is game two. Navi lost the first game. Orange took them out. They had a massive advantage. Navi did a great job fighting back in the mid game. It looked like there was hope for them stopping the anti-mage. But in the end, they lost all their wrecks.
You can't let the laning phase go that badly. And by badly, I mean that laning phase went about as terribly as you could possibly let it go. If you're, if you can do a better job protecting your carry, that dual lane was kind of weird. I mean, Puppy obviously isn't going to be somebody that makes a mistake, lets himself get hit by the tower a lot. Just a bit of a misplay.
That was a little weird.
Yeah, if they cut out mistakes like that, they can do a really good job. I mean, Dendi's been kind of having a rough tournament so far. You know, we're not seeing like the standard Dendi, but that was about as close to
what you expect out of him. Yeah, exactly. He did great that game, honestly.
He actually exceeded his lane. He beat a Queen of Pain, essentially.
Yeah.
I think he was winning in CS.
Yeah, he was.
He had like a 13-minute Aghanims with a bottle, and he was actually doing fantastically. Roars were on point, axes every time. The boars were always there. I mean, when he caught Ned from blinking with Zan King, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So if you can kind of utilize Dendi, he's playing at his high level. Havast minimizes those mistakes that he was making, and if the laning phase doesn't go as bad, then Navi, I think, can take this game.
Yep.
They just showed that they can at least play to an even footing with Orange.
Yeah, definitely. Well, let's hop into the game, guys. We're into game two here. Navi is, of course, at a 0-1 disadvantage, not a 0-2. First pick out of Orange is actually going to be a Nyx Assassin. Made it through the pool. We don't see an anti-mage ban, but there's, again, a Wisp ban and a Batrider and a Visage.
Yeah, and that Darkseer ban, wow. Phonix vacuums.
They really did. They won a fight or two because of that. The first Rax attempt, the vacuum into Burrow Strike, things like that. Comboing AoEs on support heroes, that is like the money moment. When you see those guys eat AoE stuns, you just know it's going to swing the team fights.
Yeah, and Curl played that fight, every one of those fights actually fantastically. Being able to steal Burrow Strike and then getting like two or three person Burrows off.
Yeah.
He was a better Sand King than Sand King that game.
Dang.
Dang.
So mean.
So meta. But Nyx actually going to be picked up by Orange. That's a hero that we see sometimes. It's like sometimes you see him, sometimes you don't. And in return, Spectre and Enchantress is going to be picked up by Navi. No Chen. A little bit surprised to see that. But Enchant does give you a better like level 1 to 3 where you can get multiple creeps, whereas Chen can only take hold of one. And also, the heal is quite good from an individual perspective. You know, it keeps her alive. And late game, she scales a lot better with Imbidus.
Yeah, with she does a lot more damage on herself. Would you say she is a squishier hero than Chen? But I feel like once she gets some HP into her, like an Aghanims or something, her dying to Nyx Assassin is probably not going to happen.
Yeah, the
in
untouchable?
Comparison to Chen, like Chen doesn't have a lot of escape options. He's like, well, I have a mech, I have an Aghanims, like that is it. And like, what are you supposed to do?
Yeah,
you just laugh. That's it.
and Untouchable is really good against carries too, so she does a really good job of staying alive during stuff like that. But Nyx Assassin going to be picked up first for Orange Esports. Sorry, you guys. Okay, we're good. So one more pick left for Orange. Not really sure what they're going to pick up.
Hopefully not an anti-mage. I don't think I can handle seeing an Orange anti-mage.
Mushi, like sometimes. All right. I don't want to criticize him, but he definitely overfarms.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, well, I could take all of the farm in the world. It's like, he's kind of saving up for, like, a hostage negotiation system. He's like, I'm just going to save as much money as possible, and I can get my daughter back with this.
I think you need multiple millions for that one. I don't know.
I mean, if any player's going to get to that, it's going to be Mushi.
Okay.
I got Merlini to laugh with that terrible, terrible analogy.
Oh,
so.
God.
Yeah,
that's definitely why. Yep, that's.
I've got perfect dad humor. I'd make a fantastic father. Anyways, we've got Alchemist picked up by Orange Neolution Esports. That's a hero we previously saw on Navi. Maybe they can make it work a little bit better this game. It's one of those heroes too. If you get behind early, we always see it like come back.
Yeah, that was honestly Havos did a great job coming back. I didn't think he was gonna get. Vaguely even close
like
to anti-mage's farm.
He was like level 2 at like 4 minutes or something like that.
And then he did 3 levels into Grievel's Greed, and he actually got items up at a reasonable area. I was really surprised, honestly. He did a great job farming back up. That was great.
Yeah. So, Navi.
Wow, a Bounty Hunter ban?
That's a hero that we haven't seen banned or picked in so long.
Yeah. Doesn't get picked very much anymore. It's really random. Is there some strategy? I mean, it would give Spectre a lot of movement speed. Maybe that's why they don't want to deal with Spectre being, like, max movement speed. Or for example, even if you use Spectre ulti, it doesn't have to necessarily be Spectre that's really fast. If you can just get the illusions that fast, it really does a lot more damage.
Yeah. And Rubick actually going to be banned. I absolutely agree with that decision. If there's a hero that goes one and one with the player, it's Rubick and Kuro. I mean, that game.
Yeah.
He almost saved it. Yeah. He was like blinking around, never dying. He had so much farm. He had like a 22-minute blink dagger and arcane boots on a support Rubick. The one thing though, the way that Kuro does play is a little bit more greedy, in that he doesn't really help by those wards, those sentries. Mm-hmm. He kind of leaves that to Puppy, and then he's like, "Well, I'm gonna farm."
It's pretty good purpose though. Like putting farm on really talented players can produce results.
Yeah. And it just kind of hurts. It just kind of hurts Puppy a little bit.
Yeah. He died a few. He took a few for the team that game. It's definitely true. He
definitely took a few for the game, or for the team. But Dragonite gonna be picked up by Na'Vi. That's definitely gonna be Dendi's hero this game, unless they try to fake us out again. That was like the most poorly attempted like fake out, you know?
Oh, the swap.
Yeah.
Like, where
I remember reminds me of like two kids in a huge trench coat trying to pass off as like an adult.
Wow.
It fooled us though, so.
Did. I was really excited. I was like, oh, cool, they're going
to
put a mid.
We would definitely
nobody's
sell alcohol to
forever.
Little kids by accident.
How am I supposed to tell that they're
exactly.
over 21?
We go by height, but anyways, Dragonite going to be picked up for Na'Vi, and a lot of the long lane heroes have actually been banned out. There's no Batrider, there's no Clockwork, there's no Bounty Hunter, no Darkseer. What's
Wind
really
Runner.
Left in this pool? There's Windrunner, who Funic plays really well. Mm-hmm. There's Nature's Prophet, which still exists as well, and we saw Orange actually pick, like, a one Nature's Prophet for Mushi the other day.
That was a really weird game. It was fun to watch. I was like, that's weird. I've never seen somebody do this before. It opened my brain a little bit.
And there we go. There's the Nature's Prophet picked up by Orange.
But it's going to be an offlane, though.
Yeah, if you can't get an Anti-Mage, if you're not going to pick an Anti-Mage for Mushi, mm-hmm. you're going to get something like an Alchemist or a Nature's Prophet. One of those farming heroes. It just calls to him.
He needs to hit level 25, get 6 slotted, and continue farming. It's the only way.
Yep.
So, a couple bans left for each team. Na'Vi gets to do their next pick here. They have their mid hero, they have a jungler, they have a hard carry, they need a support, and they need an offlane. Now, Orange is most likely going to put Nature's Prophet in the offlane, so they could save their Windrunner pick for the last one. Unless it gets banned, of course. Orange does have one ban left over. Do they grab the Windrunner now? Or do they pick up their support hero? All the supports are in the pool, pretty much, except for Shadow Demon and Visage. And they grab a Beastmaster.
So that's going to be the offlane hero for Na'Vi this game. You've got 3 melee heroes, but with a lot of them have large initiations. I mean, once you get the Elder Dragon form on the Dragonite, uh-huh. you've got a stun, you've got a Roar Pang with that, and then you've got Spectre with his dagger and his ult. So you've got a lot of distance closures on Na'Vi. A lot of good initiate, too. The only thing that they kind of lack early is that burst damage. But it should be okay. And the laning phase is going to be a little bit... 10 seconds. It's always a little bit wonky when you pick this many melees, but...
Yeah. Dude, all they have to do is get a Vlad, and that's GG. Yeah. I mean, how much free lifesteal do you get?
Pizza GG once they pick up a Vlad on that Enchantress.
No kidding. Thank you, Papa John's, man.
Thanks, Papa John's. Thank you for sponsoring esports. So, Orange has got two more picks to go. They need... If that's going to be... I mean, mid-Nyx is actually quite common, as is support Nyx. It's a good pick in general because you can put him both ways. I know I've seen DK running both ways before, as a mid for a super and as a support.
Yep.
For QQQ. So let us see how this goes.
I feel like if they grab, that'll be a next mid. They can gank with Nature's Prophet with it. I guess that would be kind of good. How do you feel next matches up against Dragonite? I feel like Dragonite has a moderate advantage.
You do okay. You kind of always lose the lane with Nyx in general. But the strong part of him is once you hit level 6, you can kind of get free kills.
Okay, so what is this, Silencer?
That's a Silencer support.
Silencer support versus Spectre. Okay, the plan is wait till Spectre uses Haunt, then you pop Global Silence. I saw this in a scrim once, and TC was playing the Spectre. I think Fluff was on the Silencer, some IXDL or something. And they would pop the Spectre ulti, and then the Silencer ulti. It would stop Spectre from haunting. So it forced the Spectre to get a Manta style, which was weird because, like, it would be like Global Silence, and he would have to Manta out just to remove the Global Silence, and then he would teleport in and leave his illusions behind. And it felt like the biggest waste ever.
Yeah.
It was a big waste, but like you had to do it because you have to get through. You can also BKB, but that feels a little bit of a waste on Spectre, don't you think? 10 seconds remaining. You gonna talk?
Yeah.
Come on, what's the problem?
5 seconds remaining. People aren't here at the studio right now, so they're really confused, but Jared's like dying. So what we're doing right now, I'll just tell you the secret, guys. Whenever I'm talking, Purge is something to try to distract me, and vice versa, and we're getting like steadily more ridiculous. So, okay. We should analyze the draft, though, and stop messing with each other.
I was totally doing that, and you're making faces.
I wasn't making faces.
And doing things with your hands.
Okay, so Crystal Maiden going to be picked up. That's the last hero for Na'Vi. That's a really well-drafted lineup. They've got a lot of disables. They don't lack for stuns. They've got teamfight, late game. This just feels like a really well-rounded lineup in general.
A lot of those heroes need mana as well. I would like to point out Spectre especially. A lot of Spectres are grabbing Drum right now to increase his mana pool, but if he even like maxes Dagger or something like that and has a couple levels of Crystal Maiden Aura, he needs mana. Enchantress will like it. Dragonite, definitely a big bonus. And Beastmaster will be spamming axes, especially if he does do Ancients. So, like, Crystal Maiden again pulls in. The draft is perfectly centered to be benefited from the support, and hopefully for Puppy, he doesn't get killed as many times this game.
Yeah, and Windrunner actually going to be picked up for Orange and picked up by KYXY, their mid player actually. So I think that's a support Nyx and a mid Windrunner.
Interesting.
Yeah, against the Dragonite.
Windrunner versus Dragonite. Power Shot's great. It's magic damage, so it's magic damage is great against Dragonite because his armor's high. So, and it's very spammable as well. You can get CS with it as well. So
yeah.
I don't know. It looks pretty good to me.
Should be
Orange
okay.
Has good team fight. Their stuns are okay. They're not super reliable though. You're banking on Shackle Shots. You're banking on Unstable Concoction. Nyx Assassin stun is not the best for initiating, I would say, unless obviously you break Invis. Like, it's not like a Roar or something, you know?
Yeah. So, last pick. I'd imagine everyone's here. They're just kind of throwing out strategies for themselves. And actually, I see Syndarin in the chat. Syndarin's actually the worst answer I know. So, let's announce the lineups. This time, I will go first with Na'Vi. We've got Puppy playing Enchantress. Havas going to be playing that Spectre. Dendi on that Dragonite. Kuro going to be playing that Crystal Maiden, and Funnic, last but not least, going to be playing that Beastmaster for Na'Vi.
Of course. Puppy's going to be playing Enchantress, not the Crystal Maiden. Makes sense. So for the rating team, Orange currently up 1-0. We've got Net on the Nyx Assassin. We've got Mushi playing Alchemist. KYXY is on the Windrunner. We have X playing Silencer, and the last player is going to be Ohio playing Nature's Prophet offlane.
Okay. So, Na'Vi, they've got a really well-rounded lineup, but so does Orange. They're kind of lacking Hard disables. I mean, you've got the Alchemist stun, but that's kind of chancy. Support Silencer doesn't really have a whole lot for you, and Shackle Shot is a bit iffy as well, right? Mm-hmm. It's not a lot of reliable stuns on Orange, but at the same time, I mean, the Global Silence gives you so much overall teamfight, and it's really hard to mess up.
Yep. And as with the pro-level players, they're not going to mess that up. They're going to time it correctly. Hopefully going for kills as well. They can use the same thing to shut down Spectre. They don't necessarily have to use it to defend against his ulti. If they want to go aggressively gank him, it's such a great way to prevent him from reality into a different lane as well, because every time he pops his ulti, just stop him.
And Dendi slightly trolling and telling KYXY wants like some free bottle. And hopefully he doesn't lose it this game.
Yeah.
But I mean, I'm really excited to see Dendi play Dragonite. The last time we saw him play it, it was a bit of an anomaly because he instantly lost the bottle.
Yeah.
So that was a bit skewed, but
yeah, that
hopefully
was up
this
against
game
the Slark.
Yeah, this doesn't happen. And Funnic actually just getting ready to place with the wards, but actually realizing that there's a sentry there, so not gonna be able to stack this like he wants to. And Puppy being chased away by this tree. And
no, that's his.
They're oh, it's
out.
His. He stole it.
Yeah, man.
I was like, what's going on?
So pulling, they're gonna take the Dark Troll. He'll be able to farm with this pretty rapidly here. Mid lane matchup is Windrunner versus Dendi. Dendi's starting things off with a Deny, looking pretty good. And Ohio pressuring Kuroki. Whoa, I said that wrong. Kuroki back. I almost went Kurokai, and then I tried to like mix the two.
I just say Kuroki. I don't even know what the right one is, but everyone calls him Kuroki.
Kuroki, or Kurokai, I believe he's all okay with. Yeah. I've seen interviews. Okay.
It's like everyone that calls AUI Aoi, even though it's AUI.
Yeah, what a bunch of jerks.
What a bunch of jerks. And KYXY, can I just spam out that? And I'm actually kind of lagging a little bit. Feels like things are kind of just like skipping in time. But KYXY going for a mass right-click build middle. Going for four Ironwood branches and the circlet, which gives you a ton of stats.
Oh, wow.
First blood being taken by Na'Vi this game.
Huh. So that was a Troll Warlord net, followed up with a Frostbite, and a bit of a dagger on right click to get the kill. So nice pickup there for Navi on the top lane. Pretty typical thing for Beastmaster to do on the offlane, by the way. You just kind of throw axes, kill this big room, the big group of trees, a little bit of deforesting, and that allows you to spot out the support heroes. So he can just basically stand within vision range of the silencer. They don't actually have to fight. And yeah, at least then it takes one hero to force him out of the EXP range. So they're both going to take a hit there. And he's going to go rune control bot as well. Actually, we have Net coming in position. He's going to be able to mana drain this. Maybe axes come through. Last second, that's a regen. Net's going to pick that one up. Gets a lot of heal out of it. And throws a mana burn as well. So pretty costly for Funnik. He's going to have to run back to base from this one, I think.
Yeah, and he's only actually level 1. He's doing as much as he can in the lane, but not really getting a whole lot out of that. And his pull was actually blocked. Most of the time, we just see this mid, or this jungle Beastmaster. Mm-hmm. He just pulls the Ancients repeatedly, and then you just axe, it hits them all, should do fine. But this game, Orange correctly ascertaining that Beastmaster is going to attempt to do that, so they place a sentry preemptively, and kind of just shutting off anything he can do.
Phobos in the main lane going full aggressive item build, 2 levels of Desolate, 2 levels of Dagger here. It's going to give him a great early game. He's picked up Boots already. Man, getting that kill is going to help a lot, though. Level 4 already is so high.
Yeah, and Dendi doing just fine mid right now. He's actually at 10 CS, beating KYXY by just a little bit, but KYXY is going to get his bottle soon. And this is actually kind of just a trade farm mid matchup. It's going to be difficult for Dendi to get a kill, but it's also going to be difficult for KYXY to kill him, just because everyone's just going to bottle spam out. Yep.
If he does hit 6, it'll change things up. They're going to go diving on the top lane, actually. That's a TP out from Nature's Prophet. He did juke into the trees and teleported out. That's actually going to cost him some EXP. He's going to have to run back to the lane. It'll be a while till he gets there, so... The wave is about to push up as well, so this was a guaranteed creep wave that he would have gotten. Oh, he's getting a TP, so it'll just cost him a TP scroll. Not the biggest loss. Phase Boots picked up on Spectre now, some more diving will be coming after this. And he's going to get pretty much every last hit from here on out as well.
When you dive like this, though, it does give the the offlaner some farm. And so Nature's Prophet, although he did die, he's doing pretty good in XP. He's level 3 already, whereas Funnik at bottom is only level 1. So it's kind of, I feel like it's kind of worth it to die like that. Mm-hmm. A first blood does give you quite a bit, give up quite a bit. But the worst thing is an offlaner, I mean, you don't want to die, but at the same time, getting 0 XP, that's not exactly a good trade. And yeah, Funnik's really still level 1.
Do you think he should just be on a small camp right now? Because his Ancients are warded. He's got a stout shield. He could possibly go do it. He's going to rune control again at the 4-minute mark. It's an invis. He can just sit on it. He's going to grab it. Dendi doesn't really need it because he's just bottle crowing heavily. We see some dive again, actually. Puppy comes in from the back. Ohio in trouble. Here comes the Centaur Stud. It's going to land, actually. And this is going to get Hovost into position. More right clicks. Needs some Desolate to score the kill. And he does grab it. A second kill now for Spectre. He can also use his Centaur to tank the tower as they escape from this. And Puppy going to start things off, though. He turns on his heal. He's going to be just
Puppy's
fine.
Puppy's going to get blocked by this Treants.
Oh my god.
Oh god, he actually almost died there, but
he
gonna
took
be okay.
Way more than he needed, I think.
Yep, and Havas gets his second kill this game, and as we saw through the stats, he actually does quite well on this hero. But the lane once again is gonna push, and Ohio maybe decides to TP up here again and just try to leech some more experience. And the bottom lane is starting to finally push out, and it looks like they want to do this. The catapult creep is here. Catapult creep, just the catapult. With the creeps, 2 range creeps. And,
great position from Ned from the other side. Funnik's
is that
going to
be a kill?
Great position. He might go down. It's going to be really close. Yep. And the last word's going to secure the kill. Silencer picks it up. No stolen int there. He does pick up a curse at the silent level, but great swing around from Ned there. Typically just doing a lot of pulling, but there's no ward on the bot lane, and getting him between the tier 1 and the tier 2 allowed him to sink the kill. And this might be a tier 1 tower fall as well. Most likely will go down, especially with the catapult.
And I think this is going to be a tower as well for Orange. So... Ohio actually going to be of use here. Using his Treants to tank this out. The catapult is still in good condition, so this should be a free tower for Mushi. And maybe going to go for, by the looks of it. Oh, and mid, actually, KYXY going to die.
That was a gank from Puppy, a stun, followed up by a Centaur stun. So, pretty good choice. If you don't Windrun before the first stun hits, then you're going to die. Because 4 seconds of right-click is too much against a Windrunner. Her armor is very, very low. So, she has to stay alive. No boots for her yet, either.
And 3-1 now for Orange, or for Na'Vi over Orange. And Ohio going to come into this lane and try to pick up some XP. And the bottom lane, because of the tower being pushed like that, Funnik should be able to finally get something. And he's actually hit level 3, so he's doing just fine. Well, just as fine relative to a long laner, who is level 1 at one point.
Crow, in the meantime, has been jungling. He's level 5 already. Holy cow. Going to really good job there. Pretty typical for CM, though. You use the Frostbite on the neutral creeps. We saw Puppy doing that one of the previous games. We check out his hero level. He's up way above the enemy supports. By an entire level. Isn't that obscene?
Yeah, actually, just Frostbite alone lasts so long on neutral creeps, so you should be able to do the big creeps pretty easily without taking too much damage. And that should give you, like, half a level every time to a full level, depending on how low you are.
So Nature's Prophet comes back to the top lane to try to defend things. Spectre's almost level 7. He's going to have full combo here. Denny transfers his bottle back once again. No mistakes this time. How much do you think he practiced bottle transferring?
I mean, I'm sure he does. It just seemed like more of a mistake than anything, and yeah. I don't know if Dendi will ever make that mental slip up again.
Yeah, it definitely is something very rare. Especially on Dendi. Think how many times you bottle crow a match.
He probably just
misclicked.
They have
a lot of practice, yeah.
More than anything. You can't really do anything about that. It's not really practice, right? It's just try not to misclick, but it happens.
Yep. Power shot's going to come through. It actually is going to scout all the ganking heroes, I think. Both Kuro as well as the Beastmaster. There's actually a lot of Na'Vi players
KYXY,
sitting mid.
KYXY, he has to know this is coming, and he's going to...
There's a Windrunner. Wow.
Windrun. Wait. Oh.
I like the Bracer pickup for Windrunner, though, because it is a bunch of burst damage when she does get ganked on the mid lane. And since her armor is low, there's a lot of magic nukes. She has to try to stay alive here. There's some good poison damage being done to the tower as Denny focuses occasionally. Breathe fire as well, and most of Na'Vi's here. The only person that is not is the Spectre, but keep in mind, he has a global presence. He could be here if he needs to. So it's going to be really hard for Orange to defend this, because if they don't actually get in position and find a favorable team fight, they're going to be at a disadvantage, and the Spectre's going to be farming the whole time.
It's difficult for them to team fight too, since Extinct is only level 3 on Silencer. Mm-hmm. So you're not going to see the global silence quite yet. He's actually just hit level 4, picking up a level of Glaives of Wisdom, just in case they get kills and he can steal intelligence. And Mushi, meanwhile, is just kind of... trudging along, farming in the top.
Ohio might be dead. We'll see. One more right click. Doesn't get him. Not quite there. Puppy maybe needed to throw an extra impetus, but big loss. Hobos is going to lose some HP, but they can use the heal on him. A little bit of a mistake from Puppy actually healing the creeps. Maybe more than Hobos, but...
I really like this rotation, too. Extinct is actually just going to come here at bottom and push this lane out and farm, while his Alchemist is just going to do the jungle camps, knowing that he's got 4 levels of Grievous Greed. So this is actually worth it for him to do. And the lane has been stacked, this large camp is being stacked by net right now. So Mushi's actually just going to do this and let Extinct get a free level 6. And I think what Na'Vi should try to do is gank him right now. Just because, I mean, it's a silencer. It's a really easy kill, but instead I think they might try to take mid. Dendi's actually popped his Elder Dragon form. And he's got an Invis going,
ooh,
so yeah.
I like this TP here. He's going
to Extinct
come down.
Has to be worried. I think he's not, though. Doesn't know about the Invis, but Kurok...
Oh,
does go down mid.
He's so in trouble. Here comes the first hit. There's the stun. Going to see an Axis as well. Very, very easy kill. That puts Funnuk up to level 5 and one level closer to 6, which is where this offlane here starts getting really nice. He's got 1,000 gold. Is this going to be an Arcane Boots? If so, he will have mana for the rest of the ground. And there it is. Arcane Boots picked up. So, almost level 6 on him.
Yeah, he's actually caught up in a big way. I wanted them to do that too, and they ended up doing it just because... I mean,
really
that's
happy.
A silencer. It's a free kill.
Yeah.
He has no way of getting away. He's level 4, and it's going to give Funnuk a lot, considering how bad Funnuk's had it this game. And the axes are going to fly, and finally, stacking going to be happening by Funnuk, as no longer Sentry Wards over there. But a Battle Fury is finished on Mushi now, and that's a 10-minute Battle Fury, and that's another stack he's going to do.
Yeah. So, really nice for his allies to do this. The downside to all the Grievous Greed levels is the Acid Spray is low, but it doesn't matter now that he has Battle Fury. His HP regen is not that great either. He's got to stay alive.
Yeah, but Acid Cloud does a really good job of farming.
Yep, he's going to be okay. Kuro picks up level 6 now. Hobos is still farming pretty much unhindered. Let's check out the GPMs, though. I'm sure it's much higher in Alchemist. It is at 512, just because of the nature of Grievous Greed. The Battle Fury as well is going to give him accelerated GPM, because there's no way that you can match that DPS output with just a regular right-click. Unless you're like Lycan or something.
Yeah.
Ooh, Dendi in trouble. He actually does get picked off in the mid lane. Believe that. Yeah, that was a gank with Nyx Assassin using Invis and follow-ups. Almost a TP from Ohio as well, so he was definitely going to die there.
And KYXY finally starting to get his legs under him. Had a hard time mid against Dendi. Did die once that early, but finally gets a rebuttal kill. And Dendi getting really close to a Shadowblade, though. And opting not to go for that BKB that we see so commonly.
Well, he doesn't even have treads yet, by the way. So that's a super fast Shadow Blade, which means that he's not going to have as much survivability. I mean, maybe if he had treads there, he could have survived, for example. Instead, he tries to go for full offensive potential. Or at least, you could also say defensive.
Pretty greedy, I mean, in general. But, oh man, Mushi's farming all of this jungle camp, letting Extinct just kind of catch up. And Extinct's actually got a global silence now. So the team fight for Orange goes up by a lot. But Havas, he's got 2,000 gold now and a free tower top.
Is this going to be a rain? It's great deny from Windrunner, actually. Really, really nicely done. It's going to delay a lot of gold. Curl with boots. He's got 2,000 gold. I think it almost has to be the Manta, though. It really will depend. He can either adjust from this playstyle-wise, like he can just push with his team, or he's going to have to grab a BKB or a Manta to stop it. Neth's trying to get another kill mid. Dendi's going to back up. He's so close to his Shadowblade, 200 gold away. If he can finish this, it'll be a really nice boon.
Yeah, Neth actually scouting with his ultimate right now. Not sure if he's going to do anything. Ultimate does end. A whole lot going to go for him now, and Mushi might actually do this with the help of the Treants. He's going to drop the Acid Cloud. Just do this entire Ancient farm.
And there's just stacks everywhere. He doesn't have very much attack speed because he opted for a Phase Boots, but he is going to pick these off.
Gosh, his farm is actually going to go through the roof right now. Maybe going to go for a BKB after this, I'd imagine.
Does it stop Desolate? I believe it does, correct?
Maybe. It is. At the very least, you're going to stop the Dragonite stun. And anything else.
Yeah, you're right. Dragonite's done. If he goes BKB, though, Beastmaster can't Slow Roar him. They have the natural counter to it, which might hurt things. So, Dendi finishes Shadowblade. He's coming to the bot lane. He's got his ulti picked up as well. He's going to be waiting for a hero if possible. Ohio still does not have his hand of Midas, so he's not doing the best. I'd say Beastmaster actually doing pretty well, considering the fact he's slightly ahead in GPM farm.
Yeah, Dendi going to push this bottom tower out. Looks like the entire Na'Vi squad is starting to gather out. Havas isn't there, but obviously he can haunt in, although he's kind of low and he's got no mana.
So maybe he's got to get back to
base. He's actually running back because he realizes that there might be a fight here. And it looks like Orange is just content to trade because Mushi's so damn farmed.
Yeah, Puppy's trying to pull them back, and he actually does grab a lot of the creeps, but a Glyph here is going to hold Mushi back for a second, but also going for a Shadow Blade, actually. Shadow Amulet, the first pickup. And the Tier 1 bot is going to go down.
Actually able to save mid.
Top?
Actually got 400
Dendi.
Top.
Ooh, does not get denied by Dendi, so trade one for one there. Good pickup for Orange, and a nice counter push by KOIXY.
Yeah, and it looks like he might be going for a 4 staff. Picks up the staff of Wizardry, and then Nyx gets a kill on a solo Puppy.
And he was actually pressuring a lot in the mid lane, but swinging around there, able to get the kill. So 4-4 at the moment. Keep in mind, Orange is up one game. Their gold advantage continues. We're going to see Kuro escaping the jungle as fast as possible. And they need to reformulate a plan. I mean, Dragonite's not that tanky yet. He does have Shadowblade, stealing runes and things, but I mean, Orange's counter push is really solid at the moment. I feel like they're just outplaying Na'Vi a bit on the map.
Yeah, and Dendi actually going to Shadowblade forward, but KYXY knows what's up. You know, I can't actually see the game. It, like, completely freezes. I'm pretty much just going to have to cast off your PC now.
Perfect.
Nice.
Look at everything I look at.
Yeah, because nothing I see, everything happens about, like, 5 seconds later.
I don't believe you.
Okay. You don't have to.
Mushi doing a great job jungling. This is one benefit of being Radiant Alchemist. You can very easily pull three camps into one giant Acid Cloud. Try it sometime. It's really fun. Pull three together, drop the Acid Cloud, you kill three neutral camps, wait 60 seconds, bam, all three are going to respawn, assuming you don't block them, and then pick up some more GPM. It's really showing in his last hits. His last hits are really high, and his overall GPM, his net worth is amazingly higher than Spectre's. He's already like 3,500 gold ahead. Really, really paying off. And Havos is so close to his relic. 200 gold away. I assume it's going to be a relic at this point. If you've got 3,600 gold on a Spectre, you're definitely making a Radiance.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. And it's actually going to help Havos deal with the fact that Grievel's Greed is helping Mushi just get so far ahead. And Mushi actually just killing creeps at top now.
Well, Kuro picks up a Blink Dagger, or I assume he will. He's got 2,300 gold. Dendi opted to let him take last hits. Kuro accidentally grabbed the other dragon, so he's going to be able to make a magic
Wait,
a
Blink
one.
Dagger?
I assume. He's got 2,200.
Oh, you said Kuro. I was, like, so confused.
Oh, Funnic actually making a mech instead, so not going to be a Blink. Another item that costs about 2,300 gold.
Yeah, and a Hand of Midas finished on Furion. Nature's Prophet, I mean. And it looks like everyone's just kind of gearing up for a long farm game. There's a Hand of Midas on this Nature's Prophet, which you should get, you know, just to catch up. Yep. And a Radiant's going to be, I think, for Havost. The thing, though, about playing Spectre this greedily is that you can still die really easily.
Yeah.
Just with the Radiance and a Bracer.
Yeah.
That doesn't make you very tanky.
The Radiance timer is still huge. Like, the window for you getting killed, like you said, is massive. It doesn't matter if you have a Radiance. You're 1,000 HP, relatively squishy here with 7 armor.
Yeah. Maybe setting up a kill top for Mushi on this...
Wow,
the Spectre.
The sentry wards being placed by the Radiant team to cover against Dendi's fast Shadowblade are just so well done. This is the second time that Dendi's been looking for kills and has been spotted up by sentries.
Now, double stun the top doesn't really accomplish a whole lot. Funnik knew it was coming and just kind of sat behind him, and a mech is completed on him. There's a lot of heals coming his way. Navas going to continue to farm, and I think his Sacred Relic's actually finished. Being delivered to him right now.
Cool. So he's going to have a Radiance, a lot of AoE burn damage in the next team fight.
Yeah, looks like nobody really wants to fight. Everyone's just kind of farming out. And Dendi's going to go for a BKB with an Ogre Club coming his way. Both Ancient or creep camps are going to just kind of going down, and Mushi playing the Ancients once more. Man,
there's been
so
much stacking this game. It's been ridiculous. It's like every time I see Mushi farming a camp, there's a stack there.
Yeah, so actually, they're going to 4-man smoke here.
His damage output's really good at the moment. Right click is pretty insane. Shadowblade and a Battle Fury, both physical damage items.
I think they're actually going to find Puppy here.
Top. Oh, poor Puppy.
Oh, they went around and around. Oh, they went both ways.
Smoke might break, but the illusion might be in position, and nothing yet. There it is. There's Heroes. They're going on somebody else. This is going to be a Global Silence on a Vos, but he already uses the dagger, so he gets within the trees. Nice job there. Stuns come through. Power shot. That's going to get them into their... He's going to be able to run, though, and up the hill, and now he's standing somewhere that I didn't know he could stand, and the nukes actually hit him. He's really a power shot. They get him. Man, a lot of effort to secure the kill on the
I didn't
director,
actually think they were going to get him because they kind of went on like weird, unpassable terrain. I was like, why didn't they just kill Puppy there? But they weren't content to do that.
Yeah.
But Havas actually didn't lose too much there. I mean, he's not going to farm during this time, but he did purchase his Sacred Relic. If he had died before that, that would have been pretty disastrous. But the crazy thing now is that Mushi is going to have, if he decides to go in AC, he's going to have it. Maybe around the same time Havos finishes the Radiance.
All Puppies get initiated on somebody, is at least. Here comes the stun. He hasn't thrown yet. He changes the target, goes on Funnik instead. Couple right clicks here. The slow. Funnik dies. Puppy may fall as well. The chase comes. Shackle Shot's not going to latch. And Puppy will end up surviving. But great observer wards from the Radiant team. This one catched all of their hero movement, and they were be able to
initiate. Oh, and Dendi at bottom. Just going to get a free kill on Ohio.
Well, not necessarily free. I mean, his team was dying for that one, but...
And Kuro going to get picked off here, trying to go up
another
in the hill.
Another death. Wow.
And now the kills are kind of just snowballing off, and that's 6 intelligence stolen by Extinct. Not too much, but once a game kind of snowballs, it is quite a bit. And they had to have known, though, they were still in the jungle. I think Puppy's death and Kuro's death was a bit questionable, considering, I mean, they had just killed him, or Havos the top, and they weren't pushing top, so they had to have been in the jungle.
Yeah. It is a bit weird. Assault Curious is finished.
Oh,
it's
man.
It's a 19-minute Battle Fury Shadowblade AC. The best part about this is that since there's a Beastmaster, he says, well, getting a BKB is probably not worth it because he's going to roar me anyways. I'm just going to go damage items and attack speed items. And he's not as survivable against AoE nukes and or nukes and things, but it doesn't matter. He's just
like
going
to
do a DPS beast. Yeah, if he gets a heart right now, this guy's just going to, like, 5-shot everybody on Na'Vi. Not even kidding, guys.
And he's not going to die either. And Havas actually... What looked like insane farm has now kind of petered out to about a 21-22 minute Radiance, which is decidedly mediocre. And
yeah.
Looking at Mushi's farm, that's definitely not mediocre or average.
Yeah, it's absolutely insane.
Let's take a look at the current net worth right now for all the carries. We've got... Jeez!
I mean, he's a bit ahead.
He's actually, like, combined the next two guys.
That is pretty impressive.
He doesn't... Did you really? I just like did the math. I was like, wow, right. Wait. Nope, that's enough for
the plus
both
side
those.
Of this is if you throw everything on the guy, he can die. Frostbite also hard counters him. He doesn't have a Manta style. He can't Shadowblade out of it. And he has no BKB or Magic Immunity. So Frostbite can be pretty crucial here. He's going in. Do they have detection? They have a gem on Funnik, I believe. But there's a stun on Puppy. Frostbite's not enough. That was a 3-shot. Oh my gosh. Funnik going to scout this out. Mushi gets the slow. TP out from Funnik. And Alchemist just going aggressive. There's so many squishy heroes, I don't even know if it's going to matter. I mean, again, Mushi is just snowballing out of control. This time on a more aggressive carry, Alchemist can do more than Anti-Mage, but it's looking great.
Yeah, they're actually just going to split push out now, and Mushi by himself is, do you see that? It's 8 minutes faster.
It's pretty
than normal. He's actually got 2,300 gold again, and his farm actually isn't stopping at all. And Havas, he's gonna finish his Radiance just about now, but not gonna be able to contribute too much to a fight considering he only has 1,000 HP. Mushi's gonna be able to just destroy him in a fight.
Yeah, he needed this a bit earlier, unfortunately for him. But the roaming ganking from the support heroes on Orange was really spectacular. Like the gank on top really helped out. Next Assassin has been able to shut down some of the other jungle heroes as well. The overall KDs are looking pretty good. Silencer is actually sitting
smoke goes
quite
off
well.
For Na'Vi, and Havas, as usual, as a Spectre, you're not going to come into the smoke just because you can haunt in. And Na'Vi, maybe look through the jungle or just sit behind Havas and try to pick somebody off. Because in a passive farm war like this, it looks like they're getting heavily off farm right now by Mushi alone.
Yeah. Well, can they run into anybody? Have we even seen Aurora yet this game from Beastmaster?
Maybe not, actually.
Maybe like one or two tops. He's maxing out Inner Beast, so their DPS in the mid game is going to be pretty good. This attack speed aura on Puppy is going to be awesome, actually, because he can dish out the damage with Impetus. Nature's Prophet's going to scout things out, though. It's at the very least, only scouts Puppy. All the other heroes are still invisible, so.
Yeah, and the game kind of just slows down again, and this favors Mushi, who's got 4,100 gold. So he's like, oh, you farmed a Radiance Vault? Well, I've got that too, if I want.
That's insane. He could definitely have an AC Battle Fury Shadowblade over the Spectre. It's kind of a bad sign.
Yeah, and Havos just going to tank up first team. Going to go in first. Looks like Na'Vi's going to push this down, but I think Mushi's going to do what Mushi does best and just split push and say, well, I'm going to force you to come back. Because they don't actually have Glyph, so they have to be really worried about this.
And he can, like, three-shot the creep wave, for God's sake. So going on the Tier 3 tower, can Na'Vi take the Tier 2? Is it worth it to trade this Puppy? Actually taking a ton of damage. We see Net go forward. He gets 4-step. Denny in some trouble. He doesn't have a BKB. There's a Shackle Shot. Great roar on Mushi to buy him some time, but it's not going to be enough. He's going to be able to get the stun off. Denny goes invisible just in time. Sentry drops, and Denny will fall. Killing spree on Mushi. They're not done yet. Kuro with the DD. The right click, the Shackle. Kuro's going to go down. Puppy in trouble as well, and Na'Vi losing three heroes. Man, Orange has some insane farm on Alchemist. And they are just crushing team fights now. Doesn't look like Na'Vi can fight them in a straight-up engagement right now.
They just weren't able to rotate at all with the Roar. They weren't able to get any ganks going with the Enchantress. And Mushi just kind of exploded that and said, I'm going to just farm this entire game. And that's exactly what he does. Na'Vi just kind of felt stiff this game with the rotation. Funnik was shut out this entire game.
Yeah.
I mean, he's 1-2-0 right now. I think I saw one or two Roars on him tops. And just getting level so slowly. And Ohio actually hasn't been able to do too much this game either, but the difference in farm between Mushi and the next two people is so great at this point that it doesn't really matter.
He will find Funnik in the jungle. I don't think he's expecting three heroes. The right clicks are insane. He goes down. That was a gem as well, given over to Orange. And man, not looking good. Alchemist takes the bot tower. 6,000 gold for this guy. Abyssal Blade is probably the pickup pretty soon. He could still get BKB to guarantee. The only thing that stuns him is Roar. And he's buying rest.
A heart.
Two hearts.
Okay, he sold both, but I think he is going to get a heart. I'd imagine.
He only sold one. Put one on the courier.
Yeah,
so
he's going to get a heart. That's what I imagine he'd get at this point. Mushi's not the type of player to get BKBs anyways.
It's a lot more fun to not.
Exactly. That would stop his farming and his DPS potential.
That's true.
You've got to go for the highest attack speed possible.
You get 40 damage out of heart and only 34 out of BKB, so why would you not get a heart?
Exactly. Every time, decisions made. So now we have a 5-stacked Alchemist at 25 minutes. I mean, what more is there really to say about that?
We're going to encounter the same problem as last game where he kills jungle camps and it gives him absolutely nothing.
Yes, but this game, he's not 6-stacked yet. And he's actually coming to a lot of his team's fights this time. He's heard the plea of his people. A Shadowblade actually built on Ohio as well, and he's got 2,100 gold. That should be an ultimate orb and a Hex coming his way, and nothing on the banks for Na'Vi aside from this DK by playing. He's almost got a BKB. He's like 500 gold away.
He definitely needs it. I mean, the stuns on Orange are solid, but they just have a couple. It's the Nyx stun, it's the Alchemist stun, it's the Windrunner stun. And Dendi's damage isn't too bad since he does have the Shadow Blade, but at level 15 before he gets the Frost Dragon,
They're both waiting at bottom right now. Dendi's going to come in here. Ned actually has a Blink Dagger and a Gem. Does Dendi know this is coming? No. He's just going to get blown up.
Stun stack, though, but will it matter? They're going to be able to pick off Dendi. It doesn't matter. 4 second stun. Onin is called. And Na'Vi, I don't even know if they can defend their tier 2 mid.
There's nowhere safe for them to be. Their entire team is split up, and Mushi's just kind of creating space by himself, for himself. And Ned in perfect position. He's actually got a Blink Dagger on Nyx. He's got so much farm, and normally you don't actually see Ned with this much farm, just because he's been playing support this entire game.
Yeah. He is doing really well. 10 assists on him. Stun comes through on Puppy. How many hits is it going to take? Frostbite stops him dead in his tracks. Acid Spray comes down. And they kill him anyways. I'm expecting GG at any minute, honestly. Like, I just don't see how Na'Vi can fight this. Like, Mushi's got 2300 HP. That's before he pops his ulti on. Gets more HP regen.
Every single T2 is taken as well. Mushi's farm is out of this world, as we've said 100 times, but you can't understate this. At 27 minutes, he's got 5 slotted, and he's got 3,800 gold. So how do you exactly catch up in a game like this? I guess you kind of have to Ultra Turtle.
Might see a kill mid, actually. KO actually being chased by Havost. He's been able to farm Ultimate Orb in the meantime.
Yeah, and actually, Haunt wasn't used there, so Havost can actually just continue to farm and come into the team fights a little bit late.
Oh, the DD. What is this? Frostbite buys him a second. Funnic trying to stay alive. Oh, here comes the hit. The slow is actually huge. Roar is being used on Mushi. Got to keep him in position. The rest of the illusions doing a ton of damage to X. Havost actually completely surrounded by enemies. More stuns. Almost getting the kill, but X force staffed out. It's going to end up surviving.
KYXY with the perfect bait right there, and Mushi with all the damage in the world. Going to pick him off, and they're going to go on Puppy now. Not really stopping for anything.
Oh my god.
He just kind of hit him for 3/4 of his life. And now that's 2 dead for Na'Vi. Vos is dead. That means no comeback potential for farm. And Mushi's actually just going to go for an Aegis now.
He definitely doesn't need it this game.
Yes, but he's going to take it.
This guy's so greedy.
It's the perfect way to play.
It's true.
The crazy thing is, like, he's got 893 GPM right now.
Bam! Didn't take it.
Oh, he actually didn't take it. Wow.
There's no way he's going to die. Like, he could have...
You would think that.
Right, he could have just the AC right now. Just skip the heart, and he's still obscenely far ahead. He's got almost 900 GPM.
He's got the next... oh my god. I just looked at... If you combine, like, the next two GPMs, yeah, or net worth, I mean, you don't even come close to him.
The next 3 GPMs any matches. He's as farmed as the 3 richest heroes on Na'Vi.
Yeah. Actually, not as much. He's a little bit behind, but...
26. 2k. No, I'm right. Oh. 20k plus... Oh, I'm sorry. You're right.
Yeah, no.
He's about 2k short.
Yeah. Doesn't matter. It's still...
Yeah, he's so underfarmed. It's bad.
Should just probably quit Dota.
Can't farm better than 3 enemy heroes. What he's doing. Net being chased. Actually, Denny's going to do a big strike. They get a kill, breaking the Onud's spree at
Mushi,
least.
It looked like he stunned himself.
Oh, he definitely did. He started channeling that over here, so he was he didn't make it.
Yeah, not really caring too much, though. They do pick up the gem, though, and Dendi finally gets his BKB, so maybe this is the time for Na'Vi to fight. They don't really have any other items to wait on.
Mushi's crazy. He's like, I think there's going to be someone in the jungle. I'm going to start channeling my stun.
He's just kind of doing like the suicide bomber, just like
there's
run
no
as close as you can to somebody.
No confirmation that there's actually heroes there, but he's testing it out. Starting to push.
Oh, and a dagger being used by KY or used on KYXY, but I think he's just gonna run away. I don't know if Havas will actually chase this out.
Well, I know who will chase this. It's Alchemist. He hasn't used Unstable though, but he's gonna be breaking in biz any second. There's the vision. Big ulti from Silencer, but Havos in a pretty good spot. He's gonna be able to run from this, and a mech on Funnic on the high ground. Will we see a roar? I don't think they should even roar Mushi. He's just not gonna die. But anybody else, can they go on him? There's the Frostbite. Here's the Roar as well. The right click. Havos right clicking. CM's going to use her ulti. He's getting down to half HP. This is the lowest he's been so far. And we see the reality as well. They're still on the chase, though. Supports are getting low. KYXY is actually going to follow the slow Mushi. He might actually go down. 3.5 seconds. He's going to throw the stun on. Only grabs illusions. And Mushi's going to die. I can't believe it. Finally drops. Puppy's not done yet either.
Buys back. But Dendi with a perfect swing around. And he's got his Frost Dragon.
Ohio
I think, is
drop.
Actually going to go down as well.
That's Aegis on him, though. Havos almost has Manta. They got to escape, but Dendi's going to pay for this one. The right click, the stun. Dendi drops.
And it looks like Orange is actually just going to march on through. Ohio TP's in, trying to find Havos, but everyone TP's out, and Havos is actually going to be just fine. Going to try to farm his Manta. Great fight, though, by Na'Vi.
Yeah.
Didn't lose too much. I mean, they lost Dendi, but they managed to force a lot of buybacks. They get rid of the Aegis. and a good turnaround by them. Not completely out of this fight just yet.
Yeah, I feel like that was really just showing Alchemist his lackings as a hard carry. He can get kited fairly well. The kiting isn't too bad. And once they finally got detection of him and they threw a bunch of slows on him, and then they did Frostbite and then they did Roar, he did get pretty limited. And it took a while for them to actually get the kill, but they worked him down slowly.
Eventually they did it, but a Hex is going to be completed soon on Ohio, and that should make things a whole lot easier for them. Just being able to get a Vulst out of the fight. Mm-hmm. And Mushi, of course, goes back to farming. We don't need to watch him. We know what he's going to do. KYXY, continuing to just farm out mid. He's getting pretty close now to his sheep, too. He's about a Mystic Staff away, a little bit less, and maybe initiating on a Vulst at bottom, but I think they realize that he's definitely protected.
The Manta's actually going to be really useful on him. If they can get Alchemist out of position, he probably still doesn't have evasion. He doesn't.
And the Desolate works on his illusions as well.
Yeah. If he can just jump on him and he's desolated, if he can desolate on top of a Frostbited Alchemist, it's going to be insane damage potential, and he could actually die from that. So things are getting more dangerous. Now that Spectre has a second core item up, he's got more survivability, he has more damage options. He's kind of like a glass cannon at the moment, since Alchemist has so many major damage items, but he's got to be a bit careful, more than before. There's a stun, actually. Oh, great! Dendi BKB blocks this disable, and he wants to initiate on net. He can pop his ulti from this one. There's his ulti, looking for the stun range. Ulti as well from Spectre, doing some burn on everybody. Dendi's trying desperately to catch up, but he can't let the stun. KYXY actually channeling out a power shot. Big mistake from him, and now he's slowed and most likely dead. The impetus comes through. He's going to go down. Invis picked up from Nyx Assassin and Aurora on X, and Navi's cleaning up two dead heroes. What is going on?
I mean, Havas does a ton of damage. Dendi as well. Just being able to pick off the heroes that are easy to kill. This is exactly what Navi needs to do. They just need to kill the heroes that are really easy to kill, pick off the Silencer, pick off the Nyx, get the Windrunner, and then from there you can kind of just play kite the Mushi.
It was such a great play from Dendi as well. The reaction time.
Oh, here at top,
that makes a difference. Nyx Assassin goes down. Oh, man, can they grab Mushi? Dendi's taking damage. There's the Frostbite completely countering his hero. He's got some huge attack speed reduction. Oh my gosh, Kuro gets two shot here. Mushi being slowed. There's another stun from the Dragon Tail. He goes down. Mushi's dead. He just doesn't want to buy BKB. That's all he needed to kill three heroes there, at least. But he doesn't have it. The Frostbite counters him. The Dragon Tail stun. Four dead heroes on Orange. Did they throw this game?
Oh my gosh. So Navi was super far behind. I mean, Alchemist had like the combined net worth of two heroes and like another. He had more than the Dragon Knight, the Spectre, and the Crystal Maiden. But Navi taking the much smarter fights, the Roar being able to use to great effect, Dendi being able to pick off heroes left and right, and it just seems like their team comp is a lot better at just sustaining and not dying.
Yeah.
And Mushi just getting kited left and right.
There's a slow on net, Roar on net as well. Dendi also gets stunned, so that breaks initiation a bit. Havas in a bit of trouble with the Shackle, but Net's going to be able to survive. Melee Barracks goes down. Navi takes an advantage here. I don't think Alchemist cares that much, because, hey man, he can still get Grievel Gold from these larger creeps. But the stun goes through. Ohio going aggressive. What is this? Another dead hero. Ohio's in trouble. Dendi's trying to make the play. Picks him off.
Ohio with that TP. That ROTK TP,
yeah,
that
kidding.
Just an absolute suicide at this point. I don't actually know what Orange is doing. They're actually just running in one by one and dying. I mean, first, Mushi tries to go in 1v4 and fight without a buyback.
Or a BKB.
Yeah, and then he just gets kited for days. And then after that, Ohio just kind of TPs into four heroes and then gets killed.
All right, what does he do now? He's six slotted. I feel like he has to sell his Battle Fury and get something better. Like, Battle Fury is a great farming item and all, but he's capped out on items at 35 minutes. He needs to get something else. This item build is not working, whether that's a Manta to dodge stuns or to confuse people or to remove the Frostbite. He needs to get something else. It's got to be a BKB or a Manta style or something. But
yeah, I think he should ditch the Battle Fury. He has to ditch the Battle Fury at this point.
Yeah.
It's only helping him farm. The teamfight potential for it isn't very high. You need to get a BKB at this point. It's obviously clear. If you can get a BKB, you can actually just knock out two heroes off the bat and make your team a lot more strong. But this throw, I mean, Mushi thought he was so strong, and he's like, well, I'm six slotted. Nobody's even close to that. But, okay, I have to see, like, the gold graph alone.
Oh, my God. Look at the EXP graph.
Okay, so the gold graph is still, like, ridiculously...
check out the EXP, though.
Oh, is it just completely... Okay.
Have you seen a 20k on EXP before? I don't think I've ever seen that number on EXP.
The gold lead was 25k at one point. That's actually... And it's still almost 20k right now. We're at like 17. And Navi's taking racks.
That's pretty crazy. Look at all these Navi kills.
Oh my god, that's so hype. I don't even understand right now what's going on.
Is that hyper embarrassment you're feeling?
Just... Mushi has to sell this Battle Fury.
Yeah.
Like, he has to get rid of it. He needs to get a BKB. At this point, he has to realize, I'm not invincible. Like, this isn't working out.
Yeah, he's not anymore. He had such obscene farm before, but there's 4-staff on Kuro as well. So anybody that even gets jumped on, they just get 4-staffed away. Oh, Puppy picks his up as well. So 2 4-staffs, fairly limited disables on Orange. 4-staff whoever the supports get jumped, whichever support gets jumped on, and then... Turn and stun, I guess.
God, that...
So you win.
This game is blowing my mind right now. I still don't understand what's going on.
It's pretty crazy.
Jeez, Ohio was the second highest GPM at one point, or net worth, I think. And then now he's been overtaken. Just... The throws. So strong.
They can still win it, though.
They're still up by 17k gold, and at one point they were up by, like, 26k. That has to be like one of the highest comebacks if Navi were actually able to accomplish this. It is only one Rax, and Mushi still has time to redeem himself and get a BKB. Mm-hmm. But Navi looking stronger and stronger by the second.
I'm sure they're loving this game right now. Comebacks feel so good, man.
It's got to be good for their confidence, too.
Yeah, definitely. Especially after the way that they've been doing so far today.
Yeah.
Having a really tough time in Group B. They ended up 1-3 of the previous day's games. Today is their first game. They lost the first... I'm sorry. This was their first set of today's games. And they lost the first one. So that means they're 1-4. Yeah. They do not want to be bottom of the bracket.
And Havas is actually getting really dangerously close to picking up what might be a heart at this point. He's got 4,300 gold. Just waiting it out. Navi has smoked his 4. Net's just going to blink out. A little bit afraid. The smoke happens for Orange as well, and there's still no BKB on Mushi, but for once he's going to fight his 5 with his team, and not just kind of go in by one.
It's a dust. I thought he had gold. Did he buy something? I'm really confused. I could have sworn he had more gold than this.
What, than 1,200? No, he had... Mushi's about where he's at.
Okay.
The crazy thing right now is that Mushi, he's finally going to fight with his team. Let's see how that works out for them without a BKB. Orange is saying, okay, we have to go. This feels like kind of like...
Kuro in trouble.
Oh, Kuro's definitely going to die.
Are they going to spot this out? There they are. Just now, he's still completely surrounded by Invisiers. Silence goes in. They're going to blow up Havos so fast here. He can buy back. Here comes the haunt. Was that the right target? Because he's coming back in the fight. They technically have killed nobody.
Mushi's getting impetus to death.
X goes down. Net in trouble as well. Ohio's going to try to TP. He gets killed. Where's Alchemist? Alchemist gets killed in the back of the team fight. They didn't even need the Spectre to clean that up. Spectre kills all the support. The rest of Navi cleans up the Alchemist without the BKB. He buys back. Can he defend this game? Or are we watching the most epic throw ever?
Okay. So, Puppy just absolutely destroyed him with Impetus. Like, ignored everything. They just kited him, held him in place. No BKB still. And Mushi buys back. He's going to go in, but I don't think he does enough damage at this point.
Here comes the stun. Lands on 2. Great initiation if they can grab these heroes. 4-staff actually pushes them out. And Havos runs to the front of the fight. He's going to get killed. So, 2 core heroes on Navi down. They're a little too greedy here. Not able to get the melee back. Dendi getting stunned next. He's going to stun on Mushi, running for his life. Here comes the sounds. Pure damage as well. Dendi likely to die.
Dendi. He is done.
Dendi done.
He's going to die. And Puppy's actually going to get picked off as well.
Wow.
And a triple kill on KYXY just as we are starting to count out Orange. It seems like every time we're like proclaiming somebody's demise, there's a big turnaround. And I have to assume at this point, Mushi, as soon as he's got the money for it, he's going to sell this Battle Fury and pick up his BKB. He absolutely needs to at this point.
Yeah.
He has to realize that being able to be kited for that long is really what's hurting them, and the impetus destroys you too. But if you get a BKB, all of that goes away. And despite dying so many times recently, 3 deaths in a row, he's still got 856 GPM.
Dendi forced to buy back here. I'm sure he's unhappy about that one, considering he was very close to the Assault Curious. He actually still has a plate mail regardless, and tier 3 takes damage. Kuro's in trouble, drops the frostbite. He's going to die for this one. Power shot comes through. Dendi in trouble as well. He gets hex. Not good for him. Didn't get the BKB off, and he dies. Oh my gosh.
And Orange coming back with this, and that was Dendi's buyback. They're going to take this Rax and maybe even just go for more. Oh my...
Oh my god.
What's going on? Why did they fight without Havost? And they're actually going to lose this Top Rax as well. And what looked like the biggest comeback I've ever personally seen, a 26k.
Spectre goes in, wants to grab the illusions. Got to
pick off gets four staffed.
Net's solo. The Radiance Burn is pretty solid, but Spectre did not commit to that one. He went after a different hero. Ohio shows up, looking for Hexphonic. Getting killed really fast. Puppy is low. Puppy gets shackled. Havost trying to fight, but the Hex, that's going to stop dispersion. And he's running for his life. Mushi preparing to stun, but Havost is so fast he might self-stun here. Great four staff from KYXY. That's going to set up the kill on Havost. How many hits can you get him? Three hits. Four staff again. Run for your life. Oh my gosh, another four staff. Oh my gosh, the Frostbite on Mushi. They needed to kill Spectre there, but they couldn't do it.
A double four staff is going to save his life, and Mushi going to come back in. I think at this point, he has to be a little bit careful here as he doesn't have buyback, but Puppy's going to get picked off. And now that's four heroes dead. Havost is the only one alive, and Ohio's taking this top racks, and Mushi's just going to go for this bottom one. And I think that's going to be Mega Creeps or Orange right now.
It's not done
it's going
yet.
At.
They got the two
they
powers.
They are going to back, though.
Spectre and Dragon Knight, that's all they need, man. Maybe. I mean, there's only five heroes that they have to fight, but can they do it?
Ohio going to come out here, and KYXY is actually quite low. He does have mech up, though, and it looks like Mushi's going to come back in here.
He's diving. He's channeling the stun. He's looking for a target if they can get out of vision. 1.5. Juke it. There's the stun on Mushi. Can they go on him, though? They're actually not going to try it. They could, though. Man. I guess if they would have gone in and popped the Manta, they would have been follow-up. Pretty crazy, man.
This game just...
Hard finished on Spectre, by the way. He's got an extra 1,000 HP. That's going to be a huge difference. He still needs some armor, but... Or something. Evasion would work.
Yeah, they're actually going to take Roshan right now on Orange. And Mushi actually sold his Shadow Blade.
Yep.
He's going to pick up the Aegis. And this makes it really difficult right now for Na'Vi to fight. But at the same time, I mean, Havost finally has his heart. It's going to be really difficult for anyone on Orange to live through the Haunt and the Manta. And Na'Vi, not quite out of it yet. They did lose the top racks, but at this point, with this farmed of a Spectre, it's not that big of a deal.
Yeah. They were going to lose mid racks in that push, no matter what. But when Dendi, as well as Kuroki, got picked off on the mid lane, that guaranteed the top racks fell. If they would have played safer and just let the mid racks go, waited for the respawn on Havost, they would have probably saved the top racks. So the game gets a lot harder now. Two racks is way harder to save than a single.
Yeah. And you want to give all the credit in the world for Na'Vi to holding. They actually only lost two racks out of that, although I think they could have gotten away with one set. And even if they lost the second set, they didn't need to die. That was the big thing there. At the same time, the game's not over for them yet. Havos is still absolutely huge. And Spectre is a fantastic carry. Mm-hmm. The Dispersion and the Desolate this late in the game just does absolute work against everybody.
Yeah, as soon as he presses Haunt, all of the supports on the
enemy
team have
to run. Okay, and Mushi sells his Battle Fury and picks up a Butterfly. Refusing to get a BKB, he just says to himself, you know what? Let's make this game a little more challenging.
This is a great pickup, though.
30, oh, of course.
35% evasion. Na'Vi does. They have no MKBs in sight. Not even close. Even Spectre picking up an MKB is never an item he wants to buy, just because...
I think if he were to get a BKB right now, though, they could push through bottom lane, and he could just pop the BKB and take racks before they could do anything.
On the Alchemist?
Yeah.
Why doesn't he buy two BKBs, trade them out... No, they share cooldown, I suppose.
That was a terrible idea. But
so much gold, though. Refresher. He like cycled out his whole item inventory. This looks like a different game right now.
He's like, he sold the Shadowblade and the Battle
and
Fury.
And a Battle Fury. How
picked
often
up
do you
an
get to
Aegis
sell two pretty major items here?
I think it's actually CTY
statement. Oh, Havost might be in trouble. He's
oh,
going
Havost,
forward.
He's
no,
going
he's
way
not here.
Far out.
Ned, here comes a stun. Here comes the... Oh, the Manta's going to dodge things. He's running. He puts the Haunt down. The Shackle, though. He's going to go down.
The global silence
global
goes
silence.
Off.
Ned taking a ton of damage from this, and he does end up dying. That was his ulti as well. Dendi's trying to fight things out, but he uses Shadow Blade. He's got to get out of here. Throws some damage on KYXY. Here comes a Wind Run. Mushi in trouble. There's the Roar. Needs a follow-up stun. And then, oh, he's so chain stunned. That's going to be it. That's his first death. With the respawn, Grace Shackle, Funnik in trouble. Ohio running for his life. Dendi's going to try to clean these two up while the Alchemist tears through the rest of his team. Net running for his life, but Puppy picks him off. It's not over yet, though. There's the Shadow Blade. Frostbite. Kuroki's got to dodge. Here comes the stun landing. He gets Dragon Tail.
Mushi, going to be kited out.
Will the RNG be in his favor? He's right-clicking Dendi, Abyssal Blade, another Force Staff as well, buys him a second. Great, another Force Staff, great supports from Na'Vi so far. Here comes
another
stun.
Gonna mean the death of Kuroki, though.
It's gonna land on Puppy. He's running for the
chase.
The stuns go. Kuro is gonna TP out, he makes it. Puppy's Ghost Scepter, he can't get the kills. He keeps getting kited. No Shackle there as well. And Dendi's coming in to clean up. Can he grab KOXY? He's got no mana. His ulti's gonna run out. There's the slow as well. He doesn't have Windrun just yet, but he's also gonna teleport.
What phenomenal play by Puppy and Kuroki saving that. I'm in disbelief that both of them were able to get out despite not having the four staffs. Mushi just stuns himself right now. Kind of just symbolic of this entire game. And being able to double four staff Dendi, Kuro and Puppy have absolutely saved this game. When Havasta bottom, the first major push by Orange came when they were able to double four staff him into safety. That saved him the game, and able to save them the game again by saving Dendi that one time. Wow, this support play. You don't actually see a CM have this much of an impact, but Kuro showing exactly how you do.
It's been a pretty insane series so far. I mean, how close have both of these games been? I mean, the first one was less close, of course, but there's been so many comeback mechanics constantly in these two matches. I can't, man. 30k net worth on an Alchemist. He's got a gem now. What a waste of an item slot, am I right? Why would he? That item only costs 850.
He might as well just give it to his team.
Yeah, no kidding.
But still, once again, as usual, we've seen Mushi just being kited and kited and kited and kited. And meanwhile, his team is just getting picked off in the back. His team doesn't exactly have the same tank capabilities as he does. And the scary thing for Orange right now is that Havas wasn't even there for the majority of that fight. Was using everything defensively, and they still almost kind of went okay in that fight.
Mm-hmm. He had a pretty good almost escape there with the Manta style as well as the Haunt, but the Global Sounds definitely locked him down. And he's going to do some split pushing top. He's got 1,900 gold. What is the next item for Spectre at this point? What do you say? Do you say a Butterfly for the evasion?
A Butter would be really nice for him.
Illusion damage?
A Butter would be really good. If he wants just pure DPS, he could pick up a Diffusal if he wants to continue to kite Mushi. But a Butter, I think, at this point, would kind of help him out a lot. Just the evasion. There's no MKBs on Orange. At least I think so. Yeah, it looks like Ohio's going for a Daedalus.
Pretty good choice. Yeah, Nature's Prophet is starting to do some serious damage.
Yeah, there's a Hex coming up any moment now on KYXY. And finally, there's a BKB picked up on Mushi. I know there's a Beastmaster Roar. But everything else right now is crushing him in fights. I mean, just the Enchant, the Frostbite, the Dragon Tail. I mean, it's not even about the roar at this point. If you can get him to roar you while you're BKB'd, or at least like after the roar ends, you BKB, then you can actually do something in a fight instead of just getting slowed to death as what's happening. Mushi, correctly realizing that, picks up a BKB for himself.
Na'Vi a little blocked in here. We'll see if Funnix summons his bird. He's looking for heroes, I assume. Let's take a look at Na'Vi's vision quick. They're looking in the Radiant Jungle at the meantime, but they don't actually know that Orange is grouped up mostly on the mid lane. Can they just swing in and take the last Rax? Net's looking for heroes. I just don't think they realize they're taking the tier 2 tower. Actually, Havos is going to get the last hit or not, but it is killed. And there's Mushi coming in. Tier 3 tower. There's the Glyph Pop. 12 HP left on this thing.
Yeah, and it looks like Mushi's just going to back out.
Puppy does not have a TP scroll. If they would have forced the fight there, that could have been really bad.
But everyone else, actually, Funnix.
Oh, Havo so close, well. Manta style, but he gets stunned regardless. Again, getting right click. Does he have buyback? I don't know if he's got it. He's got 3,000 gold. So buys back immediately. There's the Haunt. They want to fight. Going after the support heroes. X on the high ground, going to TP out. That's all he can accomplish. And here's the reality. Here comes the dagger. Any second, they're going to have the vision. There's a stun. Ohio goes down for sure. So one dead hero on Orange. Cost him a buyback on Spectre. Not the biggest loss, though. Can they push this out? It's going to be tough.
They get two heroes in return for that. The bottom tower is down. There's a naked Rax. And Na'Vi's, one of their base towers is dangerously close to dying, but they're actually holding. Havas, I mean, it was kind of a bit of a confusing mix-up there. I don't think he should have been there.
Force that forward. Mushi might be in trouble. There's some creeps or Desolate damage.
No BKB, actually.
There's the ulti from Kuro. Look at the slow on him. Great Force Staff as well from X at half HP. Host. Oh, man. Havos in trouble. Here comes the Fall Stun. He is so going to die from this one. Hex was way too aggressive. And now Havos dead for 90 seconds. Puppy's forward as well. But he's got to get out of here. Why is he even fighting? Force Staff out and run, man.
Come get healed. And Havos dies again.
Oh my gosh.
Was that the Nature's Prophet ult plus Ghost Scepter?
Yeah.
That just blew him up. And Na'Vi, after looking like they were ahead, I mean, they were able to kill two heroes for nothing, I believe, And then being able to get that turned around off of that beautiful shackle, and now it looks like Orange is going to barrel down for these Mega Creeps, or maybe even just Throne.
I don't think Funnik and Dendi can hold this off. There's not going to be buyback from Spectre. He just purchased that. There's the Hex on Funnik. Going to be a false stun. BKB is used, and there's no way Dendi can stop this. He goes on Ohio. Good damage choice, but the Force Staff on him, and there's the Abyssal Blade. This could be the end of the game. Dendi is going down. He is going to fall. Good game is called, and Na'Vi is going to take it 0-2. See, perfect prediction. Just...
Na'Vi's gonna take it 0-2.
but there it is. I said that on purpose. Screw you guys.
Wow, that game just kind of was a roller coaster of emotions, playing with my heartstrings.
Yeah, no kidding.
I don't even understand. I have to like watch this replay to fully figure out what I just saw. A 49-minute, 38-second win by Orange. What looked like a sure win, it was like a 26-27k gold lead. And then they lose a major fight after fight, and then it's like a 17k gold lead, and somehow Na'Vi takes Rax and pressures for a second one. And then Havas dying mid that one time, buying back, then dying again.
Oh my God.
It was just too much for Na'Vi to handle at that point. Na'Vi putting up an absolutely brilliant fight, though, in a loss.
They really did. I mean, how many times... I thought the game was over. I called GG pretty much. I was like, I was expecting... And usually I'm not too wrong on those. I expect the GGs within like 5 seconds. That one didn't happen. And then Mushu was like, I don't want BKB, so I guess that changed the game.
As soon as he got a BKB, man, the game got so much easier for him.
Yeah, really.
He's just
did.
Like, how many stuns or slows can I like slowly trudge through without attacking somebody before like this crosses my mind? Like, I know people in chat will be like, oh, there was a Beastmaster, but at the same time, like, why would you not get a BKB? It was like the Frostbite, the four staffs. You need something to like stop that from happening. They were just like playing parkour around him.
Yeah, they really were. So I want to hear how your guys' hearts are doing over on the desk. Did that game look good for you?
We're just in disbelief. Hotbed's actually visiting us. He's off in the corner cracking up. Unbelievable game. I mean, it was a circus. It was an absolute clowny game, but some fantastic individual plays by the support. Some unbelievable throws by the carry players on both teams.
Any lessons from EG on how to throw properly?
This game had it all, even more than game one, and I thought game one really delivered that department.
Yeah, so beginning with the draft, firstly, Whistle's banned out. I'm actually surprised that Orange didn't go with what worked for them last game, which is SD Anti-Mage.
Yeah,
but
it
regardless,
they were both available.
Yeah. The first 15 to 25 minutes went almost perfectly for Orange, except for a couple deaths by the Nature's Prophet, but it still didn't really set them back that far. He still had a 32-minute Midas, Shadow Blade, Scythe of Ice, and the Spectre only got a 23-minute radiance, which is still pretty late considering all of the free farm that he got and support that he got. So, I mean, everything was going pretty well for them, and then it all started with the Blink Nyx Assassin Impale on the Dendi BKB. It all started from there. And then they had to use Global during the BKB. Two of their heroes got picked off, and then Bushi's like, hey, let me try, guys. And then 1v4.
He saw what Havos
did. No BKB, no buyback. He's just like, whatever, I can do this.
You know what it is? He saw what Havos did in game one, and he said, I got a one-up. Havos just
I'm going to do the same thing without BKB.
Cruises his way through five enemy heroes after his entire team's been wiped in game one. Dies in the process. Mushi says, I'm more farmed. I'm going to make this work.
And then like, even
wrong.
More heroes got picked off. Like, right after they took the Rex, Furion TP'd in the middle of four of them, and
that
then
was,
it just died.
I immediately started yelling, ROTK! Oh, wow. It was a suicide bomber profit, and it was unbelievable.
Havos got picked off a couple of times, too, and then the Dendi buyback in middle, where he just died, too, right before Spectre revived. He had, like, 14, 15 seconds left on his respawn, and the Rax was going to go down anyways.
Right.
And instead of waiting, they're just like, whatever, we'll try and man up. I mean, that was pretty much the theme of the game. And
somehow Na'Vi managed to be down 27k
gold and
took Rax.
That would have been an incredible comeback.
I cannot stress enough, Orange almost managed to throw the unthrowable. There is no way in hell that game should have even been close. I mean, Na'Vi had great individual plays, but it was set up by Orange making some really questionable decisions.
Mushi's too cool for BKB. I mean, BKB.
I think Mushi just doesn't want to have fans because they're all going to die very young. Like, everyone who's a fan of Mushi is going to have a heart attack.
Best waste of gold that I farm.
Okay. They were competing to see who could throw the most. I mean, in all seriousness, we did see some fantastic individual plays. Net, Puppy, Kuroki. I thought, aside from that one blink initiate where Net went for the DK, he got the BKB off. I felt like otherwise these supports played incredibly well, and their carries just made their lives unbelievably difficult, way harder than it had to be. But
the Fury on draft pick was very strong. I think that Na'Vi was going to take it if they didn't. But, I mean, picking Spectre first is just very questionable.
Yeah, Na'Vi was definitely going to take it because yesterday I think they went Spectre, and then they went Prophet in that exact same position as the lights dim here, the air conditioning comes on. But that's neither here nor there.
It was a clowny game.
It was a
circus. It was exciting to watch, though.
And we're not done yet, guys. We've got two more best of twos coming up for you. It's the Alienware Cup, brought to you by Beyond the Summit, made possible by DPM Interactive, the organizer, as well as our sponsors, Alienware and MasterCard. Huge shout-out to them. Huge shout-out to you guys for tuning in. Thanks for sticking with us. We'll be right back soon with more action. We have another two best of twos coming up. Stay tuned.